morning.
Good morning.
I am a little sad to announce that it's kind of the last summer, week of summer. Is anybody else depressed by this? No, it's not. Okay, we're getting a strong rejection. I'm with him. Well, I will embrace that thought. However, our families with children are really out gathering up all the sunshine and the joy that they can before they settle into the fall. There are, and this is the first time since I've been here, there are no children here today on our Children's Sunday. I know. So we want to pray for their safety. Whatever they're doing, I hope they have a great time. We will not be daunted. We are continuing to grow a children's ministry here. I thank the teachers who prepared for us. But we do have one tiny issue. All of these things here need to be here. And so I'm going to invite those of you adults who would be so willing to come up and grab a candle or the Bible, and we're going to set the altar and light the candles and give thanks to God for the children we know and have and pray that God will bring us more. So that is the invitation to all of you this morning. I would like to say good morning to our online church family. We are glad that you are able to be in worship with us, and for those, wait, don't we do it in a minute? We're going to do it during the song. Y'all are too eager. Wait, one half of a second. Just sit down. We're going to play a song and you're going to do it like to a musical thing. Wait, do we have a child? Yay! We have a helper. We have a child to lead us, so that's going to be great. That's also very theologically sound. What was I saying? Oh, online worshipers, we're so glad you're here. And to those of you who have come to this service partway through the week, we're glad that you come to this worship service whenever you get here. We are so grateful that you are part of this church family. I would like to announce I want you to keep your eyes open for signups for 3 study groups. All right? And I want, when I do new membership classes, I really encourage people to, as a disciple, to look for ways to learn, to be in a small group, because that's where you get to know people and that's where you can be a little vulnerable and ask questions, hard questions. So there is Wesley Covenant Group, and they're doing a great study called Difficult Words of Jesus. And it's written by Amy Jill Levine. She goes by AJ Levine, and she is Jewish. She was raised Orthodox Jew. And she is a New Testament professor at Vanderbilt. I want you to hold that in your head for a little bit, right? New Testament is not sacred text for Jewish people. The story of Jesus is not their story. And yet, that has been the thing that she has studied, and it's what she teaches, and she comes at it from a Jewish perspective. So she tries to unpack what the rabbi, Jesus, was teaching from her understanding of Judaism. She is really funny. If you've ever get a chance to go hear her speak, sign up. So that's the first thing. Wesley Covenant Groups, and I think there's 4 opportunities for that. The next thing is we have a retired pastor in our congregation, Paula Wallace. And I'm a little bit on pins and needles to see how this goes because she's been filling in one of our clergy sisters who has developed sepsis. And so if she takes that on long term, this class may not happen. So I say that with just... we'll see where it goes. But she wants to do a Bible study and a prayer time around the idea of better together, following up on the summer series of Love Your Neighbor, and how we invite people to church. All right, so her name is Paula Wallace. That's gonna be on Sunday afternoon. We were hoping that from 3 to 4, when children are here for angel choir, that maybe the parents might want to tap into that. So, but it's open to everybody. So if you want to come from 3 to 4 on Sunday afternoon, you are invited to that. And the third one is a Tuesday morning study called Love Wins. It's a book club. It's reading a book by Rob Bell, and it is exploring, challenging the concept of hell. Do we really think that people who do not profess Jesus Christ go into eternal damnation? It's a good question, right? The author of this was soundly kicked out of the evangelical church as a result of his questions. The United Methodist Church has long embraced questions. We have long said that our minds are part of our spiritual journey, and questions are a part of that. And we have been what is called a big tent. And you may see that in publications about the future of the United Methodist Church. A big tent means that there is room for your doubts and your questions, your faith and your certainty, and it doesn't have to be the same, right? We just trust that God has got us and loves us. So the United Methodist Church has been a big tent where there's a lot of room for thought and wondering. That's all I got. My name is Julia Melgreen, and it is my privilege to serve this congregation. And today is a beautiful day to worship God. And now, if I could have some people come and set the altar.
Two brothers and one of them was green. greedy, greedy brothers, two brothers, and one of them was greedy, greedy. He said, Dad, I want my money, money. He was the prodigal son. The other good brother stayed on the farm to worky, worky. Other good brother stayed on the farm to worky, worky. Greedy brother spent his money, money. He was the prodigal son. He spent it, he spent it on having fun and drinky, drinky. He spent it on having fun and drinking, drinkies. He spent every shiny penny, penny. He was the prodigal son. The money was finished, and so he fed the piggies, piggies. Money was finished, and so he fed the piggy, piggies. He was broken, kinda stinky, stinky. He was the prodigal son. He went home to Daddy to say, I'm really sorry, sorry. Went home to Daddy to say, I'm really sorry, sorry. Dad said, son, let's throw a party, party. He was the prodigal son. The brother who stayed home was feeling kinda grumpy, grumpy. Brother who stayed home was feeling kinda grumpy, grumpy. He said, Dad, you must be crazy, crazy. He was the prodigal son. Said Dad to Sonny, we're gonna have a party, party. Dad said, Sonny, we're gonna have a party, party. My son was lost, now he's foundy, foundy. He was the prodigal son. My son was lost, now he's foundy, foundy. He was the prodigal son.
We will not tell your professors of vocal performance that just happened. But boy, was it fun. That was great. All right, so I'm going to do the scripture reading, and then I think there's a children's message, right? Okay. This is probably, okay, I love a lot of stories in the Bible. This is probably one of my favorite stories in the Bible. And I'm going to tell you what I want you to look for right now. So if you don't want to listen to the sermon, fine. But I want you to explore in your own mind, who does God look like to you? Who does God look like to you? Which picture of God have you bought into? Is God the authoritative judge on a throne who is looking for you to fail? Desperate to punish you? Is God just distant, far off, and not paying any attention? Or if you're like me, and I hope this is where you've landed in your spiritual journey, is God the Father who's waiting on a porch, looking across the distance for the one who was lost to come home? This is a picture of who God is, and it's one of my favorite stories in the Bible. I'm going to read the whole thing to you. It is several verses. This is from Luke chapter 15, and Luke chapter 15, I encourage you to read it this week. Luke chapter 15 is the story, the three stories of lost things. One sheep that went off, a woman who lost a coin, and every one of them ends with celebration. All the tax collectors, this is setting up the story. This is before the two other stories, and this is how it gets started. All the tax collectors and sinners were gathering around Jesus to listen to him. The Pharisees and legal experts were grumbling, saying, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Jesus told them this parable. Jesus said, "A certain man had two sons. The younger son said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the inheritance.' Then the father divided his estate between them. Soon afterward, the younger son gathered everything together and took a trip to a land far away. There, he wasted his wealth through extravagant living." I want to plant one other thought in your mind. The word prodigal, which we've applied to the son when we talk about the story, the prodigal son, it doesn't mean bad or evil. It means extravagant. And I want you to play with this idea. Who's the most extravagant one? Who's the most prodigal character in this story? Is it the son or is it God? Is this not a story of a prodigal God? One who is extravagant with love and forgiveness? All right. There he wasted his wealth through extravagant living. When he had used up his resources, a severe shortage, food shortage arose in that country. He began to be in need. He hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. He longed to eat his fill from what the pigs ate, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired hands have more than enough food, but I'm starving to death? I will get up and go to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be called your son. Take me on as one of your hired hands.' So he got up and went to his father. While he was still a long way off, the father saw him and was moved with compassion. His father ran to him, hugged him, and kissed him. Then his son said, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I no longer deserve to be your son.' But the father said, 'Quickly bring out the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Fetch the fattened calf and slaughter it. We must celebrate with feasting because this son of mine was dead and has come back to life. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate." Now, in this part, I want you to ponder, which character are you in the story? Now, his older son was in the field. Coming in from the field, he approached the house and heard music and dancing. He called one of the servants and asked what was going on. The servant replied, "Your brother's arrived, and your father has slaughtered the fattened calf because he received his son back safe and sound." Then the older son was furious and didn't want to enter in. But his father came out and begged him. He answered his father, "Look, I have served you all these years. I never disobeyed your instruction. Yet you've never given me as much as a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours returned, after gobbling up your estate on prostitutes, you slaughtered the fattened calf for him." Then his father said, "Son, you are always with me. Everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found." This is the good news of Jesus Christ.
Hey, everyone. So today's Bible reading is actually a parable, which is another word for a story with a meaning. And this parable is from Jesus, and it's called The Prodigal Son. So in this story, a young man tells his father that he wants his inheritance right now. An inheritance is all the money that he would receive when his father passed away in the future. So anyway, the father gives him the money. But all the son does is he just wastes the money on things that he should not be spending it on. So, the son takes a job caring for pigs because he's totally broke. He has no money. And he even starts wanting to eat the food that the pigs are eating because he is so hungry. So he decides to go back to his father's house. However, he was so mean and disrespectful to his father when he left that he thought he would ask his father, you know, "Just treat me like a servant. I'll be a servant for you." So have you guys ever felt like your sin is really, really big? Like you do something wrong and you can't come back from it? The son sinned a lot, didn't he? So he took the money from his father before he should have received it. He left him. He spent all the money on bad things that did not help him grow as a person. His sin felt so big that he couldn't even go back to his father as a son. He felt like he had to go back and offer to be a servant. So let's say this cup right here, this is going to represent our sin. How do I get rid of this sin? Well, it's kind of big. It's a lot to get rid of. Let's find out what happened to the son when he returned home. So instead of being mad or making him a servant, His father immediately forgave him. He hugged him, and he even held a huge party for him. So going back to our cup, how do we get rid of our sin? How did the son get rid of his sin? Well, we can't, right? Only God can forgive our sins, like how the father in the parable forgave his son's sins. So this is our sins. I'm going to put this right here. And this is going to be God. We're going to pour this on top of our sin and see what God does to our sins. Do you guys see that? God is literally dissolving our sins away. So, as you can see, it's almost totally gone, and soon it will be. Thanks to God, no sin is so big that we cannot be forgiven.
That is amazing. All right. I have entered the phase of life where my kids go around the house when they come to visit, pointing out things and calling dibs for when we're gone. That's a little hurtful, right? I sometimes remind them, I'm right here. I'm still here. But they it's a little hurtful. So what this son does to the father is hurtful, right? When he goes and says, I want my inheritance and I'm done, it's a big thing. I have for you a video clip, and I'm going to warn you, if you don't want this in your head for the rest of the day, put your fingers in your ears now. It's from The Lion King. It is Hakuna Matata.
Matata. It means no worries.
Hakuna Matata. What a wonderful phrase.
Hakuna Matata ain't no peasant craze.
It means no worries for the rest of your days. It's our problem free.
You know what? These two words will solve all your problems.
That's right. Take Pumbaa, for example. Why, when he was a young warthog.
When I was a young warthog.
Very nice.
Thanks.
He found his aroma like a certain appeal. He could clear the savannah after every meal.
I'm a sensitive soul. Nice infected skin. And it hurt. My friends never stood downwind.
Pumbaa, not in front of the kids.
Oh, sorry.
Hakuna Matata.
Songs to have in your head all day. Hakuna Matata means no worries. Once upon a time in America, the great stories that people knew and that bound them together were Bible stories. People knew all of them, and they told them over and over. I think it's really important, whether you decide to be a Christian for your life or not, it's important to know some of the Bible stories because they have influenced literature and history, and they're a part of the fabric of who we are as humans. Children learned to read by reading the Bible. Morality was dictated by the Bible. Literature contained references to Bible stories because everyone understood the references. The great stories Americans know now come from Disney. Those are the reference points we have. People may not know who David and Bathsheba are, but they definitely know who Prince Charming and Cinderella are. People may not know the story of Noah and the Ark, but they know Ariel and Ursula. Many people do not know the story of the prodigal son, but they know who Simba, the main character of The Lion King, is. In a profound way, our lives are lived around the stories we know and tell. Stories from our own lives, yes, but bigger stories that we share as a culture and as a people. Stories serve to teach us something about ourselves and help us to make sense of the world in which we live. The story of The Lion King and The Prodigal Son have this in common. They are two stories of leaving. And they are two stories of returning home. The reasons for leaving are different in each. However, Simba leaves home afraid and ashamed because he's been told what? That he is responsible for his father's death. He's ashamed and afraid. He runs away and lives with a meerkat and a warthog. We met them this morning. Pumbaa and Timon. Ah, you do know the story. Good job. He hangs out with them because he's ashamed. We meet him this morning in the clip as he seeks to learn the ways of his new family. And they introduce him to a new Hakuna Matata, no worries, free of responsibilities lifestyle. And he embraces it, free from all the responsibilities of leading his pride. The prodigal son from the Bible leaves for different reasons. His brother stays at home. And I thought during this part of the sermon about having you get up and relocate, and we would kind of like take a visual of where we are, but I'm going to do it this way instead. I want you to pick a side, all right? Who do you identify with, the prodigal son or the brother who stayed at home? All right, we're just going to raise hands. Which one of you understands the motivation to leave home, to have adventure, to try new things, to break away? That's the prodigal son. Who identifies with that character? That is me, by big. All right, which of you understand the motivation to honor... Which of you understand the motivation to honor your parents, to embrace what you've been taught and do the right thing? Aw. Y'all never made a mistake? Y'all never did the wrong thing? What? Not going to say it right now while you're sitting by your mom? I understand the motivation. Never tried something risky, snuck out late at night, did something you're ashamed of? I got stuck this week thinking about the motivation of the prodigal son. I understand his motivation. I understand the urge to want to break away as a young adult and try new things. I know the pain of learning many of life's lessons the hard way. Some of you surely didn't believe your parents when they said not to do some of the things, right? And tried them anyway? I had to learn a lot of lessons the hard way, in spite of the fact that my parents had already given me good guidance on how to avoid some of life's errors. Try this on. Haven't you fantasized at one time in your life or another about being free from life's responsibilities and the expectations of others? Of being on no schedule, but doing what you want to do all day? Of not having to care for anybody else but yourself? I think I'm going to speak for the moms in the room. They've definitely had this thought. It would be nice to go home and not be responsible for dinner, right? There's a lot to being a person, and to let go of the responsibility of taking care of everyone. I can imagine that the prodigal son sitting on the family farm one day wondering, is this all there is to life? Isn't there more? More fun? More excitement? More adventure? I can understand his motivation to try life on his own terms, even if it accepts knowing that he has lost his way. He does find himself lost and alone, money spent, friends who've abandoned him, a dead-end job with no hope for his future. He is at the bottom. Have you ever felt lost on this journey of life? Didn't know which way to go or overwhelmed? Wondering which way to turn, asking yourself, how can I get some peace in my life? How can I get my life back on track? Could be even more basic than that. Where am I going to get my next meal? How am I going to be free from addiction? Have you ever been lost on this life's journey? The Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, contains the story of lost things. A lost sheep that the shepherd goes to find, leaving 99 in the pen. A lost coin that a woman tears her house apart to find. And a lost son. It follows on the heels of the Pharisees, seeing Jesus sit with sinners and tax collectors. A place he's not supposed to be. In response to their muttering, Jesus launches into the story of the lost things. Each lost thing is found. And when the lost thing is found, there's a big celebration. There is no punishment for the penny or for the sheep or for the son. There is only rejoicing and celebration. Jesus' response to the Pharisees is to teach about the value of lost things, the value of finding one sheep, even though 99 sheep are safe at home, the value of one coin, the value of one lost person. The story of the prodigal son isn't a morality story about avoiding risk or taking the safe path. It's a story about who God is. A story about a God who is seeking, finding, celebrating, welcoming people home. Sinners, tax collectors, you and me, all of us, wherever we've been, whatever we've done, are welcome into this place because God wants for us healing and abundant life. The story of the prodigal son is simply a reflection of this truth. People get lost on their path. For a variety of reasons, people find themselves far from home and out of sync with their true selves. I went to a dinner on Friday night for Wouldn't It Be Lovely. Margaret Ann, my best friend, came here and spoke to you last year for United Methodist Women's Sunday. And she works with women whose lives have been rerouted through poverty, addiction, and abuse. It is an expensive program, and it takes a long time to help people come out of addiction. Two women shared their stories on Friday night. One whose mom helped her become a drug addict. She was an addict for 20 years. So for women who become drug addicts, that almost always leads to prostitution, right? So she spent 20 years in that life. The other woman also had been an addict for many, many years. They ended up coming to Wouldn't It Be Lovely through drug court, which allows you to make a choice about trying to get clean and sober without going to prison, but if you mess up, then you go to prison. So they landed in this program, and through a community of love and forgiveness, when I say a community of love and forgiveness, you should think to yourselves, oh my gosh, that's our baptismal vow. We say that to every new member. We will surround you with a community of love and forgiveness. So that community of love and forgiveness literally helped those people, those young women, find their way home. The church does that too. When we are honest about the ways we've been lost, the ways it hasn't been okay, the ways we didn't do the right thing, when we say, we messed up, and by the grace of God, not our willpower, not our goodness, but by the grace of God, we have been found a purpose, and been set on a new path. That's what the church offers. It's a gift. We are a people who long for home, and our home is always in the embrace of God. The big difference between a Disney story and a Bible story is this: God. A Disney story never pretends to tell us about the bigger picture of God or God's relationship with people. Disney stories are securely anchored to human drama, which is plenty, but without God. And in this way, they fall short for us, right? If our heart's true home is a relationship with God, a loving and forgiving community, then a Disney story cannot fulfill our heart's deepest longings. Not anything else can. Not the relationships we have with humans, or with alcohol, or with drugs, or with wealth, or with things. Nothing will satisfy us except God. Jesus wants to teach a deeper truth and satisfy a deeper hunger. The stories of the lost things acknowledge that people do get lost. People wander off, get misplaced, or choose to run. That's true. The other truth that Jesus wants to teach is this: the God we serve and worship is the God of lost things. Our God is the God of lost people. Our God is the God of lost selves. God is the good shepherd who goes looking for the one sheep that wandered off. God is the woman who sweeps every nook and cranny looking for the lost coin. God is the father who embraces the lost son and then throws a great big party. Jesus was trying to teach us something new about God. And how do we know that it was something new? Who's grumbling? The religious people. The story that Jesus told about the prodigal son isn't fair. It's not fair that a party gets thrown. The older brother gets that. Jesus is teaching something new. God knows we get lost. Here's the new message. God knows we get lost, but God isn't lurking around gleefully taking notes on our failures. God knows we get lost, and God wants us to be found, to have whole, fulfilling, purpose-filled, healed lives. Sometimes I wonder if the church has a place in the world anymore, if we really have any good news to offer. We have spilled so much judgment into the world. I know that isn't good news. Sometimes I think the church has painted a picture of a God who delights in our failings and rejoices in our punishment. I reject that picture. I read the Bible and I read the stories that Jesus taught and told. The God Jesus wants to reveal is a God of delight and rejoicing, for sure. But the God Jesus knows delights in finding us, not when we figured everything out and cleaned ourselves up, no. When the stink is still on us, when we have the memory of feeding pigs and hunger in our hearts, God wraps us in beautiful robes and sets a feast before us. The God Jesus knows delights in finding us when we are lost, embracing us when we have no hope, and celebrating us whenever we return home, however far we may have wandered, and however distant we may have stayed. So, does the church have good news to offer? This church does. We will proclaim with our whole lives a God of love and forgiveness, a community of love and forgiveness, the good news that homecoming is possible. You can return to your true self, and we'll help you. Doesn't matter where you've been. We've probably been someplace close to that place too, right? We have open and welcoming arms for all who stumble back home. We tell the stories of a God who loves us unconditionally and who celebrates our every impulse to turn our lives around. This God celebrates relationships over being right or punishment, offers love instead of condemnation, and heals our broken spirits with a great big hug and a block party. There are many stories in the Bible that I disagree with, that just don't seem true to me. But I want to tell you this story is the truest story of all for me. I hope it speaks truth to you as well. Will you pray with me? Lord God, give to us the courage to be vulnerable about our weaknesses and our failures, and to praise you because every good thing we have done is a gift from you. Every right choice we've made, we sing praise to you and worship you. We stand before you humbly, knowing our own selves, knowing the darkness and the smallness in our hearts, the ways that we have not lived up to your call to love and forgiveness. We are so grateful, Lord, for this community of faith, for a place where we can be known, loved, and forgiven, a place that preaches and teaches good news of a God who loves us, who desires our healing. And so, Lord, for every impulse we have to set our lives right, for the shame that we feel from time to time in our lives, for the messes that we get into and we cry out for a new way and a new direction, how glad we are that by the power of your Holy Spirit we might return home to a community of faith, and into your loving embrace. We give you thanks for Jesus, who told this true story. Amen.
Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory and the glory forever. Amen.
Okay, so I need to have a brief conversation with worship leaders because I skipped half of the service. Sal, did you have for us? Oh, you're going to sing for us. Oh, wait, I do not want to miss that. And why don't we end with Just As I Am? Will that be okay? Are y'all okay with that? We're going to lose a song this morning. I'm sorry about that. I got very excited. All right. So Juan, by the way, let us reintroduce. Juan, I don't know your last name, I guess. What is your last name? I can't hear very well, so this is Juan, and he is one of our new scholarship students, and we are delighted that he is here. want to let you know that if you have brought an offering here this morning, there's a plate here where you can put that, and to thank you for your ongoing faithfulness in supporting this church with your wealth and your time and your service. Thank you. We're going to do Just As I Am, Ryan, which is before the sermon because I jumped over a bunch of stuff. Yeah, thank you.
Just as I am.
So before you go, I'd like for us to tell us where you're going, and just give us a little who you are.
Hi, baby.
Hi, church.
tell us what you study.
Professor Bees.
She studies bees.
I'm a professor in biology at the University of Illinois and I study bees. And I'm working with a colleague there at Charles University, who also studies bees, and they hopefully pick up some new techniques and ideas from them. So I'm pretty excited about it. It's been a labor of love getting out of our house. But we're so thankful to be part of this church family, and if there is any blessings in COVID, is that will be a promotion for you all online with a 7-hour delay.
And Matt, how about you? What will you be doing?
I'll be keeping my job. So I'll be working in the U.S. and coming back and forth, but I help a large bank invest in companies across the U.S., and so it's great to continue doing that work.
So you're helping to build, financially help build communities, as I understand what you do.
Yeah, we invest in low-income housing and job creation programs in low-income communities and renewable energy projects.
So we are super proud of the work that Matt and Alex do. And when you come back, teach us about bees. Help us do better, okay? We would love to know more about that. We're going to miss them for 10 months, right? This baby's going to be walking and talking when he comes back. I know, and we're going to miss seeing that so much. And Alex, we are so proud of you for receiving this fellowship scholar fellowship. Fantastic. I'm going to have you come right over here. We are going to send them on their way with a blessing and with the love of this congregation. Lord God, how grateful we are for the opportunities and the joy that life brings us, for the adventure that Alex and Matt and Wyatt are embarking upon. We give you thanks for all that they are able to accomplish and for all the things they will learn and the new people they will meet and the experiences they will have. We give you thanks. And Lord, we pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would protect them, hold them close to your own heart. Help them to feel our love and our prayers while they're gone, and let them know that we are already anxiously awaiting their return. Use them, Lord. Use them to serve you and to love your people. I ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. They'll stay here and you can say hello to them and goodbye to them and hug that baby.